housekeeping things just because I'll probably forget to mention them if I don't do it right now. So everybody should have a book pre-order form on your chair. Feel free to fill that out if you're interested in the book at your leisure. Up to December 1st, you can order and get some nice premiums. This sounds like a Ronco Vegematic commercial, but one of the items is a really nice leather bookmark with George's signature embossed on it. As I said, you can order through December 1st. I can take credit card orders here if you can just catch me either after this session or any time. And then you can also go online and go to coalegroup.com, and there's a page on that on my business website where you can order directly using credit card. International shipping, I know that's an issue with some folks. We're certainly happy to see some Aussies and Brits here. I'm still working on the details of getting that done. You folks, I guess at this point, have two options, either pay cash or do a credit card thing. As I said, I can swipe those, and I'll even give them back. The question there is the shipping thing, and what I'll do, I'd be happy to do, is when we get to the shipping portion, I'll deduct what the U.S. shipping would have been, and then we can work the rest of that out. So, also, for those of you who are going to be in Cleveland, if you would prefer to pick the book up at the Cleveland Convention, there's a little check mark on your order form where you can request that. You can't do that online, but if that's your request, just shoot me an email, and I'd be happy to bring them to Cleveland for you. And I think that's it. Again, welcome, and I have some thanks. This project was a project that involved probably 150 people to date. It's been an amazing 2 years of research, and I'm very excited to share this to you. So some thanks. Wendell Jacob, who owns the San Francisco Fox Lobby Molar, has graciously supported this book for the last 2 years. It would not have been possible without Wendell. Oh my goodness. Thank you, Tom. Lou Williams has been a wealth of information, great friend, and he's also volunteered to serve as an editor, so I don't look like an idiot when I put out my my written product. Richard Rogers, if you don't know Richard, Richard was a con artist. I just like to say con artist. And again, wealth of information about George, and I have to tell a tale on Richard. He is so type A. How type A is he? That when I met him for the first time, he handed me the interview that had not been conducted yet. That's the kind of guy you want, isn't it? So that was wonderful. Mark Renwick, who is actually right there, has done a yeoman's job in compiling a complete discography and tune list. And when I say tune list, that's in there because his cohort in crime, Brett Pratt, who lives in California, Brett has listened to every George Wright track. So part of the discography mentions, you know, here's this album or this CD. These are the tracks that are different from the other version, or these are the cuts that are different from another version. So it's very, very informative, with dates as closely as we could nail those down. So the discography tune list is a tremendous addition to the book that thankfully I didn't have to worry about because I have two very capable assistants taking care of that. Finally, Robert Hope Jones, not that Robert Hope Jones, but the great-grandnephew, I think. Is that correct, Richard? Great-grandnephew? Something. Just nod your head. Okay. Of that Robert Hope Jones, a brilliant artist who lives in Hong Kong. And these folks all stepped forward when they heard that the book was going to be written. And so Robert is going to do the artwork for the book. He's also started a project where he's colorizing some George Wright photographs that I sent him. And I think if you see those, you'll be as wowed as I was. So stay tuned. Finally, John Nelson, the inimitable John Nelson from the Allen Company. John holds the record as the longest interview, 8.5 hours, with one very short potty break. I thought I was going to die. And in the 8.5 hours, we did not complete our business. So I had to go back and visit John once more. Of course, had a great time. Dwight Beecham, he's the guy to thank for you being able to hear George this morning. He massaged a MIDI file that originally came from the house organ, the Hollywood Philharmonic organ, and massaged it for this particular Allen model. So you are the only folks in the world who have ever heard that way. So big thanks to Dwight, and of course the Allen Organ Company, for allowing us to use their room. End of commercials. The book itself is divided into geographical chapters. George started out in Orland. Orland is in Northern California. It's almond country, middle of nowhere. Fortunately, George moved to Stockton in about 1933. Unfortunately, George's father, John, was, I could call him an alcoholic, or you could call him a drop dead, you know, drop down drunk, and that's the reality, and that came from more than one person. Not a good start for a kid growing up. John did not want to get into the family business. George's grandfather was George Ephraim Wright, and he was a blacksmith by trade and opened up the local farming implement place in Orland. And John chose not to continue with the family business and ended up going to Stockton. And many of you probably don't know that George had a brother. Albert was born 2 years after George. And unfortunately, they never really made it a good connection. So they kind of went their own ways. George was at Grand Union High School. He was recruited by the superintendent there in 1936. So George spent his junior and senior years at Grand Union helping to modify the existing style lead and then putting together buying a number of organs, putting together the instrument that is there now. George actually was an employee of the school district, worked as an office clerk. At least that, I guess that's the way that they could get money to him and help support him that way. But he primarily spent his time working on the organ. He played radio shows. The high school had a direct connection to KROY in Sacramento, and George would play radio broadcasts. And I'm happy to report that just 3 days ago, a digital version from a transcription disc of one of those 1939 radio broadcasts, 15 minutes long, from Grand Union High School, is now in my possession. So that's the kind of stuff that we're going to be sharing on the website that accompanies the book. So very, very exciting things. I also have a Blue Network recording, 15 minutes long, that I also just received. So lots of goodies. Oakland was the new Shanghai Terrace. The new Shanghai Cafe and Terrace Bowl restaurant, as George would love to say, the whole thing. And that's kind of a fascinating segment of his life, where his first job, he was fired and rehired, but that's another story. He was almost killed also in 1941, so there will be more on that in the book. George actually worked with Sammy Tong at the new Shanghai Cafe and Terrace Bowl restaurant. And Sammy Tong was better known as the houseboy on Bachelor Father. But at that time, he was a wonderful singer and MC. George started playing at the San Francisco Fox in December of 1942. His rising star rose very quickly. I mean, it was an amazing thing when you read letters from George to the Schoenstein Company, written when George was 17 and 18, to see, I mean, George was George from the get-go. And there's a cute little story about George contacting Otto Schoenstein and saying, I need a reed, I need a branch, I need 61 pipes. I don't care what it looks like, I don't care what it sounds like, but there's a post horn in the Del Paso Theater that I can get if I can throw something else in there. So you may fill in the blanks on that. So at the time he was playing Fox, George was also involved in the Mutual Network and the Blue Network in San Francisco. Again, very rapidly rising star. NBC transferred George to New York City in 1944. Contrary to popular belief, the New York Paramount job had nothing to do with George going to New York. He didn't start that until October of 1948. So that job was held just a little more than, well, about a couple of years. And again, in New York City, he was heavily, heavily involved in radio, as well as the job at the New York Paramount. Very busy guy. Then back to LA in 1951 to 1998, involved in radio, TV, of course, General Hospital, a good long run there, and of course, all the recordings, you know, from the Rialto concerts, the Crown concerts, the South Pasadena studio organ, and then ultimately the Hollywood Philharmonic organ. Other elements of the book. I mentioned the discography tune list. There's a detailed timeline of George's life that'll be on the web and also in the book. Currently, it stands at somewhere around 300 entries. So I've tried to chronicle basically all of the major events in George's life, recordings, concerts, those kinds of things. If any of you would like a digital version of that timeline, please email me, and I'd be happy to provide that to you, because I'm trying to get as many eyes to look at it. If you have some additions, as long as you can substantiate them, document them in some way, I would very much appreciate that. Lots of letters. I've been privileged to interview, I think, 45 people, and have a large number of letters from George. Very telling and very helpful in terms of positioning events in his life and just kind of where he was thinking at any given time. I have 16 3-inch binders full of images. Now that could be documents, it could be correspondence, it could be photographs, all that stuff. It could be official documents, birth certificates, death certificates, those kinds of things. So there was no way all of that could go in the book, but again, everything would be up on the website, including the audio, the edited down, the necessarily edited down audio from interviews as well. And the website, as I said, I've purchased the domain geniusofgeorgewright.com. There's nothing on the site yet because I've just been too darn busy, but I will let you know when we have that up. Okay, we start in Moreland. The house on the left is the house where George was born. It was a little bit of a challenge because the city or the county, I'm not sure what entity, renumbered all of the homes. But this is the one. I was privileged to interview George's surviving cousin up in Orland, and she's 85 and just a delightful, delightful woman. Upper right, the gravestone of George's grandparents, and down lower right, that's little George. Now I mentioned Albert. You see Albert on the left and George on the right. George is 9, so this is 1929. Upper right, you see the Wright farm implement store. And in the lower right, again, contrary to popular belief, George's first piano teacher. Not Lou, but Aunt Velma. And George started with piano at the age of 6. Why am I taking pictures of trees? I'm glad you asked. The house in the upper right is the house of Grandma and Grandpa. And as I said, George Ephraim Wright was a blacksmith by trade. So the imprint of a horseshoe still exists in the sidewalk going up to the house. And when George was 4, Grandpa wanted to, I guess, maybe send a message to him in terms of sustainability or whatever, but he had George plant a redwood seedling on his 4th birthday. And that's the tree. There's George with his cello. Multi-talented guy. So this is Orland Grammar School, his graduation pictures, 1933. The photo in the upper right is the Orland Theater, where Lulu played piano. A cute little place. And then lower right is an interior shot. And that's actually John. That's George's dad. And now we move on to Stockton. You can see geographically, we've gone from way up there to way down there. San Francisco is here. This was perhaps the most significant thing in his life, potentially. The move to Stockton allowed George to take lessons with Inez McNeil. And Inez McNeil was really what got George going. You know, she was playing organ at the Fox Stockton. And George treasured the time that he had with her. Here's a recital program from 1937. And George is playing both piano and organ. He does a Debussy arabesque, and then he also does the Rhapsody in Blue Jesse Crawford arrangement. So there again, you see the Jesse Crawford connection very early. Another interesting thing in Stockton was, it's difficult to see in the picture, but toward the right is the Pfeffer Music Store. And on the left is a kind of a bookplate thing for the Pepper Company. Lower right, the geekiest picture I have of George. This was taken about 1958, and this is the little Wurlitzer in the Pepper home. They had a Wurlitzer in the home. They also had an organ in the store and one in the radio station, and you can see the antenna out back, and that was KGDM. And there's the Fox, California. This is a picture of the radio studio organ. And that's actually a card from Pepper's to George. And now we move to Grand Union. George was recruited by the superintendent, Bill Rutherford, to come to Grand Union, a very, very elite high school, in 1936 in the fall. This is a spec that George drew up for the Kilbin console and the organ that was installed. Following the style lead that was there. George playing Hammond out by the pool. And then lower right, that's George's graduation picture. This is a program from a large number of programs that George played during his four-year stint at Grand Union. Again, junior year, senior year, and 2 years of postgraduate study. Lower right seat from the style. There's a good picture of George at the Kilbin console. Upper right, that's Bill Rutherford. And George at the console. And then George with the toy counter in the lower right. Again, programs that George played. This is the January class play. And then he's shown as office clerk in the upper right. In the lower right, that's a letter between George. George's high school diploma, his high school graduation program, and that was the play that's just the cast of the play. Now we move to Oakland. And here we have 20-year-old George Wright at the console of the new Shanghai Cafe and Terrace Bowl restaurant. I've exchanged at least a dozen emails with one of the sons of Fong Wan, who was the owner of the restaurant, and it's been fascinating. We've put some pieces together that nobody ever knew before, so stay tuned. Upper right, you see George at the console. He's there with his pianist. I just last week got into contact with that guy, the pianist's daughter. So she's digging through and trying to find pictures. And lower right is a drawing of the Shanghai Terrace and an advertisement for the shows. Okay, here's George on the Blue Network. Upper right is a promotional shot that was taken. KFRC on the right. Here we have, this is kind of fascinating. On the left, you see the San Francisco Fox with the midnight show tonight. George Wright at the organ, sing time, jamboree. So that was quite the deal. And the big banner in the lobby, radio personality George Wright, and then in the lower right you see George playing the lobby organ. Now off to New York, 1944, NBC calls.
Perfection. Swift's premium Franks now come to you cellophane wrapped in handy 1 pound packages. And now for our weekly visit to Riverdale. It's Friday night as we're looking on the Andrews home. Late Friday night. Mr. and Mrs. Andrews are in their bedroom, sound asleep.
So you get the idea of George Wright on the Hammond. This, if you're not familiar, George recorded under the name of Sister Slocum. Vocals by Dyke Brothers. I don't make these up. I'm just the recorder. In addition to that, I now have a 1949 letter from George on near Paramount Stationery that talks about lamenting that he had to record with Charlie Mignani, accordion player, Tony Mottola, wonderful guitar player, but that the Hammond that George got was the oldest model that existed in terrible shape, and the piano was even worse. And he said, we refuse to let that go out under our names. So that was the genesis of the Sister Slocum stuff. And it's wild stuff, I believe. And again, this will be up on the website. George played with the Charlie Mignani Trio Quartet for all 7 years that he was in New York City. Interestingly enough, in doing my research, I tracked down a guy who called Charlie Mignani Uncle Charlie. Not blood relatives. Charlie was just a very close personal friend of the family. He has sent me 132 tracks of George with the trio and quartet, and photographed all of the transcription disc labels. So, again, that'll be up on the website. Very cool stuff. As I said, October of 1948, George ends up at the New York Paramount. An interesting thing, I have a San Francisco Fox news article that really focused on, you know, what was so special about George Wright, and one of the many things, obviously, was the fact that George could play Boogie Woogie on the organ. That very well could have been his ticket into the New York Paramount. As I said, George also played a lot of radio shows. I'm a Whistlin' is, as far as I know, the only piece of music that has George's picture on the cover. And feel free to read the inscription if you can see it.
Insurance Company of America, Newark, New Jersey, presents everybody's favorite whistle man, Jack Burt.
I'm a whistling. Are you listening? For this pretty little ditty that I'm singing all in rhyme. Hello out there.
Hi,
Eddie. This is Jack Birch, Eddie Dunn, the Charles Mignani Trio. All the boys ready to hang out the Monday sunbeams. And they're coming around to see if we can make a good day any better. Now, Angie thinks a bluer sky might help. Yes, sir. Tony would like to add a warmer breeze. But Georgie thinks today's okay the way it is. And he's right, because I have to admit, yes, it's a good day for singing the song, and it's a good day.
Upper right is George with Tony Mottola. On the lower right is a soundy.
Just you.
my dreams, and without you, dear, I don't know what I'd do. In this heart of mine, you live all the time, sweet Sue.
George recorded for Thesaurus, which was the RCA transcription service. He also recorded for Muzak and for AFRS as well, the Armed Forces Radio Service. We have a nice certificate that George was awarded for his service there. And I missed one. What is it? Associated. Yeah, Associated was the last one. And again, all of those, thanks to Mark and Brett, are in the discography. And it's amazingly long. I've got a copy up here if anybody wants to look at that. Now here's George, 1951, just back from New York City, sitting at the Vaughan organ, of course. Now, here's a trivia quiz. Clearly, the Roaring Twenties was recorded at the San Francisco Fonz. What's wrong with this cover?
Someone said there's a misspelled word?
Yes, there is. And ironically, the word is World Scissor. So there you go. Bill Field, do you know anything about that? Well, okay. Just want to make sure you were still with us. This is an interesting thing. I've never been able to substantiate this. It's talking about a gold-plated miniature console presented to George for his millionth record sale. So one has to wonder. I can tell you that Rich Vaughan was an expert at promotion and ballyhoo. So take it for what that's worth. George did lots of different things, jazz and razzmatazz on piano, and George also did a very few arrangements that were published. This is George in 1957, I believe, and this is, and I forget the name of the club, but this is in L.A., and he's playing the Hammond with a solo box and with a Steinway piano jacked up above everything else. The Jack Kirkwood Show was another zany radio program that George was involved in. We've got some cast photos up there.
Jack Kirkwood Show!
You ask me, she sounds ravishing.
Ravishing?
Ravishing.
Ravishing, I'm having your part of me. Ravishing, I'm having your ecstasy.
The Jack Kirkwood Show came in two flavors. At one point, it was a 15-minute show, and George would get a 1-minute solo. The 30-minute version, George would get 2 1-minute solos. So, some amazing stuff. I have about 60 of those.
Perfectly armed to the leg.
Again, it's wonderful, fun stuff. Hearing that reminded me that George was once billed as the world's fastest organist. And then earlier at the New Shanghai Cafe and Terrestrial Restaurant, he was called the Console King. So, of course, he deserved all those titles and more.
Would you like to be queen for a day?
Here we have George in L.A. Okay, number 8, you have Crown Promotion, lower right, the Rialto, that iconic picture of George in front of the marquee. Thank you. Here we have a display. This I can't remember. I have to look where this was. This is a record store. Just showcasing all of George's albums to date. The picture on the right is from July of 1962. This is crazy stuff. This is George playing at the Hollywood Bowl. Skitch Henderson conducting the Hollywood Bowl Pops Orchestra. By George's records, he was scared out of his liver. Well, I wasn't going to say that, John.
Scared shitless.
And the only thing I can assume is that they had a forklift behind this and shot him up in the air.
What you can see, he's hanging on for dear life.
Oh. Here's on the left, pictures of the Pasadena studio. And I have a number of pictures, quite a number of pictures of the studio. I don't have any with the complete finished setup, unfortunately, but I keep opening. And again, the iconic picture in the upper right. The lower...
You about had to have oxygen when I pulled that out, didn't you?
It's true, yeah. This is Solo Records' second release, except it didn't get released. This ultimately basically became At the Movies. But this was Solo Records, which didn't do so well. George would never be recognized as being a businessman. There's George's handwritten score for the General Hospital theme. And upper right, he's playing his various keyboards, and then the cast picture on the lower right.
General Hospital.
And by all accounts, George was in a separate booth, so none of the actors could hear what he was doing. But George would have the directors in stitches at each rehearsal, because it's George, you know, this is what happens. But again, just as George, when the actual performance came around for the live taping, the consummate professional. I mean, that never varied. Here's George. I think the back of this picture, George wrote, "The Last Time." So this is the farewell of the fox. Absolute tragedy, but that's where we are. Here's a picture of George at the Senate in Detroit. And I have to remember to send this picture to Lance Lewis, because somebody borrowed George's picture from the Senate. This is the home installation, the Hollywood Philharmonic organ. Everybody has animal skins in their organ room, I guess. And again, that was the other look of the console there on the left. The mural on the right, that's the artwork that we're using for the book cover. At least that's our plan at this point. And then George and with Tom Shute on the right. George's not very accurate obituary, but he certainly got broad coverage in major newspapers and, of course, Variety. At this point, I'd be happy to entertain any questions. I need to say that this presentation was 0.03% of what's been collected by George. So the research for the book is about 95% complete. I have two more fairly major interviews to do, and stuff keeps trickling in. That's been the amazing thing about this whole project, is that it is such a collective effort. You know, I can't thank people enough for their contributions. And if you happen to have things, information, whatever, again, please, feel free to email me. The easiest email address to remember is George Wright Book, all one long word, no spaces, no underscores, georgiabook@gmail.com. Anybody have any questions?
I do.
Did you raise your hand?
No. How many pages?
You know, until you do it, you don't really know how many pages. I'm guessing 600 to 800. The key is that the website is vital, because there is just so much stuff. There's no way I could fit it into anything less than an unabridged dictionary form. Thank you, John.
All right, my other question is...
Oh, we get two now.
That, before I was so rudely interrupted, my other question is, why should I give you $95 for the book when you keep talking about a website? I'll just wait for you to turn the website.
Thank you for asking that very important question. And I did not pay John a dime to do it, but I might afterwards.
You did not coach me either.
Totally unrehearsed. The key to the website is that you must buy the book to get password-protected access. There will be a front end with some generic stuff and some items you can probably purchase. The wrong code that you made, part of the website. But the real meat and potatoes is restricted to those people who buy the book. So and that's a lifetime subscription. Websites don't.
The sound files and photos are copyable on the website or not?
Probably not. It just depends. There's a lot to be done with the website, and that basically has to be done.
Do you want me to shut up and go behind
screen? If you would, please. And you had a question.
Yes, before he jumps in.
Did you become a convert for a month?
Oh, gosh, don't say anything
different. George was with Coale, two different occasions. He did a 12-city tour in 1971, and of course, the three recordings that George issued on Coale's. So George was a con artist, and he also played con artist.
I showed up at the gymnasium that was extremely hot. Once said to my father that his hands felt like glue. You would have never known that.
And again, the consummate professional, that he did the job no matter what. Anybody that does remind me of something, if you know of a performance where George performed, I would appreciate that information. But I ask, make sure that you really know the real date, and if you've got anything to support that, like a program or a newspaper article, that would be greatly appreciated. And again, email is the best way to deal with that.
George was a colorful and complex character. One might even say a collection of characters. I'm curious about whether this book will be more of a glossy overview of George's public life, or will it contain information that really tells us who George was?
That's a great question, and I'm going to preface my response by saying this is a scholarly book. That does not imply any ability on my part to ignore parts of George's life. That's the reality. This is going to be an exercise in tact. In tact. Being tactful. So, but yes, I mean, it's part of the very, very complex person, persons, that George was. Yes?
I noticed an obituary, it said he picked a Radio City. Did George play Radio City?
Well, yes, he did.
He
played one night for Mrs. Rockefeller, who wanted to, anything. There's some great, I've got a Dave Judge letter that's priceless too. But if you knew George at all, I only met the guy twice, but living with George for the last 2 years, I have white mares. And you'll understand, Ted, if you knew George, you'll understand where this is going. Here's Mrs. Rockefeller. She invites George to play and offers him a job to be the assistant to Dick Liebert. I rest my case. Who's next? Let me go to the back. Dean? You know, that's a great question because it brings up one other thing that I forgot to mention earlier. I have purchased Banda, and that is potentially very, very significant on one of many fronts. I have the complete remaining CD inventory, the master tapes I'm going to pick up in about a week, and most importantly, the rights that Terry held. So what I'm hoping is that recordings that have been lying dormant for a long time can, the main thing is they have to be preserved. I am not in this project. Contrary to my hucksterism up here, I'm not in this project for money. This is, it's bigger than that.
Yeah.
I don't know yet. The question was, do I have the hi-fi master tapes? I haven't had a chance. Terry had you know, a gazillion tapes, so we had to sort all that stuff out. So I'm going up in about a week. He did mention that he had a late 40s recording. So that's got to be New York. So stay tuned. Yes?
Excellent presentation, by the way. With regard to your book, are you going to do it on a nice coffee table size so the pictures will be properly reproduced?
Excellent question. The format is going to be an 8.5 by 11, so it can be full sheet, because that's 100% on almost everything. There are very few items that are bigger than that. And again, the website gives me the flexibility, so we want to do everything justice. Art.
Yes, Bill, I told you a childhood memory of listening to George doing radio broadcast from San Francisco on an AM station. Were you able to confirm that and what station it was?
I'm still digging, and I'm going to confess that there is so much George Wright information in my head that it's leaking out and probably on the floor. I have a listing of about 30 radio programs that George played, and that's very difficult research. Many of those shows are not credited, and the other thing that happens in radio is that they kept changing staff. So George was credited, for instance, with playing Let George Do It, ironically. And as best I can figure, he played two episodes, because Eddie Dunstetter and his orchestra played that show for a long time. And typically what happened in the 50s, budgets got cut, and they would go to organist only. So I know that, and of course George knew Eddie Dunstetter, and so that was an issue where he played a couple times, but he still gets credit. Russ?
What is the publication schedule for Volume 2, George Wright Exposed?
Thank you, Russ. What I say to that is, buy me a drink.
Well, buy me pizza, it's even better.
Thank you, Bernard.
Okay, we're talking about the broadcasts out of San Francisco. There were the broadcasts, somebody playing a small organ, you know, was it the Cadillac dealership? Or was that somebody else playing there along with the Canary Birds?
Oh, that was over
the
shop.
Well, that was over the
shop. Sorry, but thanks, Artie. Oh, yeah. Oh, the other fun stuff is I have a stop list from the KFRC organ as George would have wanted it. And George drove Albert Lachelle to the edge because poor Albert would come into the studio and never know what he was going to play that day. Not in terms of music, but in terms of what the heck's in the chambers. I have another letter from Charlie Hirschman, the organ man, and it was the installation contract. 2 years later, there's another letter from Charlie Hirschman that says, basically, this contract is null and void if you let anybody in the chamber.
Bill?
Guess whose name could be attached to that?
It's me. This is partially a set-up question because we already discussed it, but I think it's important to understand. In Bill doing this book, I'm sure everybody under the sun says, what about, what about? My what about question to Bill was, can we define where George's style came?
If you've not purchased the Sierra Chapter ATOS CD of George Wright and Grammy High School in 1949, I suggest you do so because the money goes to help restore the organ. More importantly, these recordings of 19-year-old George, there is no doubt who is playing the organ. And it's phenomenal because when you think about it, George, at the most, had access to an organ for about 6 years. With one teacher. I mean, George just oozed musicality and style. And George was a voracious radio listener. Again, living in the middle of nowhere, George Wright really treasured his time listening to not only American, but British organists. And of course, there was certainly an influence there.
Good doctor.
Yes, sir.
A couple weeks ago, you gave me a whole...
Good doctor.
A couple weeks ago, you gave me a phone number. I was able to contact about some old radios and stuff because we have some radios in the family. He gave me a location in the area that has transcriptions of radio programs in a museum with quality status.
Don't tease me,
Bob. I'm not teasing you. It's actually the broadcast museum. It used to be the old KRE stations in Berkeley. It's now moved to Alameda into the telephone company building where the first female operator operated from. They have all the stuff put away. And I just remembered I have some transcriptions at home on wax recordings. And we can keep going. We can keep going because we talked about Frank Benz, who was a good friend of mine. There was another person on that original ATOS photograph that was part of this. That was one of my good morning wake-up scripts for me today. Bill and my mom live two blocks from each other. I live in Walnut Creek now. We're just discovering how much more information we have between the two of us than we had any idea. And that gentleman we had to call, he's got more stuff. Plus, he's got old 35mm projection equipment and all the stuff out of the projection booths. This is a guy that needs to pick into pieces. He put it on our website of different pieces. Because even though what he's going to do is a good friend we had, Dick Martell, in the Bay Area, he's in his late 80s. And now we've got to create something great.
The thing I neglected to mention, and I need to mention that because we have some dignitaries here from University of Oklahoma, home of the ATOS archives, and I am doing everything under the sun to encourage folks who I encounter on this marvelous trek to consider donating their theater order materials to OU. They've been very helpful. They're great people there. I've spent most of the day in the archives. I need to get back, but I've been too busy. But again, the sad thing is, the reality is, in most cases, here's a good example. If Chris Mangelli had not had that connection and reference for Charlie Mignotti, I wouldn't be sitting here with 132 tracks that probably nobody in this room, including myself, have ever heard. That's the nature of research. That's the nature of history, that it tends to just go to the four winds. Part of the band's purchase was also the acquisition of a tremendous amount of George's personal memorabilia. And I haven't even gotten it all scanned yet. But it's wonderful stuff. And again, once it's gone, once you lose the connection, I bet there's not a person in this room who hasn't looked at family pictures and said, oh, I wish Grandma had put the names on this thing. Because once you skip a generation, the party is over, you know, and that's a tragedy. So that's my quest, you know, is save the hobby, save this tradition, you know, and keep the history alive and well, because it's fascinating. I'm ready for the George Wright movie to come up, because it's just a great story. I mean, such an incredibly talented man who, and I've said many times, if it were not for George Wright, we would not be in this room today. And this is important stuff.
I don't have a question, but I want to give you an example of choosing your right mate. I took my wife in 1962, or somewhere about there, to go see a George Wright presentation at the Fox in San Francisco. My wife slept halfway through the program. Choose your mate right.
Well, I just want to say thank you to Dr. Bill Coale for finally doing what no one else has done. So can we say thank you to him?
labor of love. And I never, you know, 2 years ago, I never would have imagined that I would have been able to interview, to meet so many wonderful, wonderful people, even John Nelson. It has been absolutely fantastic. As I said, it's probably, I have an Excel spreadsheet, and I think it's up to 150 people who have been involved with this. One quick little tale was, I was down at the Motion Picture Academy, the Oscars Library, and after my visit there, they were wonderful, they had everything prepared for me. Subsequent to that visit, they had donated, duplicates donated, and they went out of their way to contact me and send me those duplicate materials. That doesn't happen, folks. You know, so people, I think people realize that this is a really important quest, and it's a significant thing for theater, because you get one shot to do this. You know, somebody says, oh, this, you know, should have been done 20 years ago. Well, one could argue that, but you could also argue that there's a lot of stuff you wouldn't hear 20 years ago. The sad thing is we've already lost one person who I've interviewed for the book, and I'm just thankful that I've been able to contact as many people as I have. And again, if you have somebody that I've missed somehow, don't feel that you're going to insult me by suggesting a name that may appear obvious to you, because I may have missed it. So this is all about picking up loose ends. And the thing that drives you crazy about biography is you have to, at some point, say, this is as good as it's going to get. And my get-out-of-jail-free card is the website, because I can always put up errata, additions, and, you know, all that good stuff after the fact. So, yes, a couple more questions.
This is a little anecdote. I was program chairman of Rochester Theater Organist Society. At the time, we were looking to get George back for his second concert. And I wrote letters, and I had no answer. Finally, I just out with it. I got a condolence card, I put it in an envelope, and I outlined the envelope in black magic marker. And I don't remember if I got a phone call or a letter from him, but it was if it was a letter, it was in big bold print. Don't ever do this to me again. And I said to him, that is a time for
me. There you go. George was George. We are running out of time, Bob.
Here's one thing that I want everybody to think about. My grandfather dropped dead very suddenly. We went over to the house several months later, and there was a roaring fire in the fireplace. Grandma was throwing everything into the fire. Now, let's jump ahead to right now. My mother is 92 and in the home. Unfortunately, we stopped her. She's gone through 3 shredders, programs, documents, newspapers, and things. Watch what you've got in the family.
Yes, indeed. That's a great message. Do we have any more questions, or are we? And I apologize for my voice. My sinuses were draining like crazy, so I took an antihistamine, and I'm drier than the Sahara Desert.
Sounds just like you, Bill.
Well, thank you. Thanks, Eric. Are we all set? You've been a wonderful, wonderful audience. Please come up, you know, anytime during the rest of the convention. Say hi, tell me a George story, or hand me a form with money. and whatever the case may be. But again, thanks so much.